while since we've done our rational functions, but if you will recall, there were two issues that we had with rational functions when we're talking about plugging in values, okay? We had two situations where our functions were undefined or where we got errors in the table. Do y'all remember what those were? Poles and asymptotes. Which ones? Vertical asymptotes, okay? So your domain for rational functions is going to be all real numbers except for poles and vertical asymptotes. So that means we're going to have to remember how we found those, okay? Poles occur when you end up with 0 over 0. Vertical asymptotes end up when you just divide by 0. So both cause the function to be undefined. Any other number, we're good. You plug it in, you're going to get an answer, except for the x values that are poles and vertical asymptotes. And for the most part, the range is going to be all real numbers. Sometimes there are a few exceptions. And we'll hopefully look at some of those in the examples that I've got here. Okay? With a few exceptions, sometimes we've got some gaps, but we'll look at that here in a second. All right, so let's look at number 16 there on your worksheet. Let's analyze its domain and its range. So if its domain excludes poles and vertical asymptotes, we need to begin by finding poles, then vertical asymptotes. So factoring, okay? It's always factoring. In the numerator, we need to begin by taking out a GCF of negative 2. And in that case, we get x squared plus x minus 6. Notice that is slightly different from the denominator. Just ever so slightly, but it will make a difference. Let me make sure I didn't make any mistakes there. Take out my negative 2, so it's plus 9. Yeah. All right. So continue factoring. The numerator is x plus 3 times x minus 2. The denominator is x minus 3 times x plus 2. So it's so close to canceling out, but it doesn't. So we don't have any holes. But we still needed that factoring for two reasons. Number one, we need the denominator in factored form because that's where our vertical asymptotes come from. Number two, we need the numerator in factored form because eventually, either probably tomorrow, we're going to talk about x-intercepts and y-intercepts. Well, x-intercepts come from the numerator. So it helps us out even though nothing canceled in this case. All right, so our vertical asymptotes for this one, we set the denominator equal to 0. So we have two factors in the denominator, x minus 3 and x plus 2. So we have a vertical asymptote at positive 3 and at negative 2. So that means that our domain is, there are a couple of ways that you can write it. Using the all real numbers, then you would say all real numbers except x equals 3, and you don't have to write, you can just do 3 comma negative 2. You don't have to write x equals 3 and x equals negative 2. You can write it like that. Or in interval notation, that means that we go from negative infinity, we start as far to the left as we can, until we get to negative 2, then we got an issue. And then we pick right back up right after negative 2, and we go until we get to 3, we got another problem. And then from 3 to infinity. That's how we would write that domain in interval notation. Now, I know it looks like why didn't we just write negative infinity plus infinity? But remember, when you have a parenthesis, it means you don't actually include that number. You get as infinitely close as you can to that number, but you don't include that number itself. So even though we wrote negative 2 there, we're not actually including negative 2. We get as close as 2 as we can from the left, and then we start as close as we possibly can to it from the right, and go until 3, stop, we got a break, we got a vertical asymptote, and then we pick up right after immediately after. Okay? So I know it looks weird, but that's the interval notation for that domain.
Now, for the range,
I said that it's typically all real numbers, but sometimes we have a few exceptions. So you have to graph it to find out whether you have an exception or not. And I'll try and explain this as best I can so that it's clear. So don't forget, when you're typing this in, you type in the original. You have to put parentheses around the entire numerator. You have to put parentheses around the entire denominator. If you do not, your calculator looks for order of operations. So it sees a bunch of pluses and minuses and it has one division. It's going to look for that division and it's going to be 12 divided by x squared. And that's the only thing it's going to divide if you leave your parentheses off. Okay, so you got to make sure you have that. All right, let's look at the graph.
Alright, here is this rational function. This one has three pieces. That happens when we have two vertical asymptotes. You see the vertical asymptotes at negative 2 and positive 3, so we confirm what we just did. Alright? This range is all real numbers. And I know that because I'm focusing in on this middle piece. Okay? This side of it, as we're approaching negative 2, this side is decreasing for forever. It comes up here. It looks like a cubic function here in the middle, a little bit. And then the right side, as we're getting closer to positive 3, that side of the graph is continuing on a positive thing. We don't have any gaps there, okay? There are no gaps. We hit all the y values, from all the way down here to all the way up to positive infinity. We hit them all, so this one does have a range of all real numbers.
We'll look at one here in a minute. That's different. Yeah. But we're trying to do as much as we can without graphing. But in the end, you are going to kind of have to rely on the graph. Okay, so let's look at number 18 as well. Let's factor out a GCF of 4 in the numerator. The denominator does not have a GCF. It is just x plus 4 times x plus 3. This time something does cancel. So we have a whole at negative 4. Now when we were doing rational functions, I made you find the y-coordinate. You don't have to find the y-coordinate of the whole on these. We're just concerned about the fact that a whole affects our domain. Vertical asymptotes, we take what's left in the denominator and set it equal to 0. Okay, so we have, again, two values to exclude. This time, though, one of them is a whole, one of them is a vertical asymptote. It doesn't matter what caused them, it just matters that we have it. Okay, so you can say all real numbers except x equals negative 4, negative 3, or you can write it in interval notation from negative infinity to negative 4, negative 4 to negative 3, negative 3 to infinity. Okay, anytime you're listing domains or ranges, it's always smallest on the left, biggest on the right. So you need to do it in order. Okay. For the range, like I said, you're going to have to look at the graph. It's just what it is. It is what it is. Now, for those of you that are taking math after this, I promise you, the more familiar you become with these functions, the more confident and comfortable you are with them, the better off you will be later on. So don't just pay attention to these when you're going through them, okay? Especially these rational functions. You want to know what their general behavior is. Okay, now, here's an example of one where the range is restricted. There is a restriction on the domain. And the reason why is, what's the other characteristic that we haven't talked about with the rational functions that we talked about before? Horizontal asymptotes, right? Okay, horizontal asymptotes, that's that imaginary line there in the middle, not necessarily always in the middle, but usually it's somewhere in the middle of the graph, where our graph is going to approach that value. Now, sometimes it does cross horizontal asymptotes. The last one that we just did,
it has a horizontal asymptote at negative 2, but it crossed it because it had the three pieces.
This one only has two pieces. What's this one's horizontal asymptote? y equals 0, because the degree of the denominator is greater than the degree of the numerator.
When you look at the graph here, looking at this side, and we can change our window so we can see more over here, but this is never going to touch the x-axis. It's going to get really, really close to it. And because our calculator is kind of limited, it's going to look like it touches it, kind of like it does on the right side. But we know that it does not actually touch it. Another way that we know that it doesn't touch it is this function would have to equal 0. The only way for this to equal 0 is if the numerator equals 0. 4 doesn't equal 0. This does not have an x-intercept.
So that means that our range is all real numbers except y equals 0. And we can also write that in interval notation. We can go from negative infinity to 0, and then from 0 to positive infinity.
Okay, from the very bottom, we don't have anything at 0. We get really, really close to it, but we don't actually ever equal 0. And then we continue on above that. Yeah.
Okay. Let's look at one more of the rational functions.
This is the third scenario where our numerator has a greater degree than the denominator. What type of asymptote do we have in this case? Slant, because it's exactly 1 degree greater.
We have a slant asymptote on this one. Now, good news is, we're not actually going to have to find the slant asymptote. I just wanted to see if y'all remembered that part. Okay, in the numerator, begin by taking out an x. In the denominator, begin by taking out negative 4x. And then factor that numerator a little bit more. X minus 3 times x plus 2. Now, you may look at that and say, nothing cancels. Well, linear terms don't, but you do have a GCF of x in the top and in the bottom. So that means we have a whole at x equals 0. We have a vertical asymptote at positive 4. So our domain, I'm just going to write it in interval notation. Negative infinity to 0, 0 to 4, 4 to positive infinity. And then we've got x cubed minus x squared minus 6x over negative 4x squared plus 16x. Put that all in right. Yep. All right, so let's look at this graph. Excuse me. Kind of weird looking function, but you can kind of see,
our slant asymptote in there. But do you see that there's a gap right here between this minimum looking value on the left half of our graph and the maximum value here on the right side of the graph? There's a gap in y values right there. We're missing some y values.
So we need to find out what that minimum is right there and what that maximum is right there, because we don't hit those y values in between.
And I know that because I know that this one has a slant asymptote. So over here, this increasing kind of thing over here, it's going to continue increasing. It's not going to turn back around. Okay? Over here, I don't see as much of it, but it's decreasing and it's going to keep decreasing. We're never going to hit these y values right in between there.
So we need to calculate the minimum. Now let me show you something so you don't necessarily have to use your cursor.
Okay, I can see that this minimum, it looks like it's 1 and 2. Now I'm going to play it safe, and I'm going to say for the left bound,
you can type in a number. I'm going to type in 0 and press enter.
Instead of having to move my cursor. Like I said, I think the right side's 2,
but just to be safe, I'm going to go with 3. Okay, and then I'm going to press enter. And